the scriptures that we have today is a part of a longer narrative. And I thought it was a long time. And I want us today to walk through scripture. If you go back, this really starts at Luke 24:13. And it's called On the Road to Emmaus. The road to Emmaus that accumulates in this episode that Sister Arvella told us is something that's one of the most crucial pieces in the Christian's life and they can look to for everybody because of the fact Jesus was on the road. If we look at the beginning, it says that on the same day, they mean the same day, and that's where it starts from 13, on the same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. Let's stop right there. To them, 7 miles was like walking a block. To us, 7 miles is a long way, but they wanted to walk. And they were talking to each other about everything that had happened. That's what the scripture said. And they talked and discussed this, and Jesus himself showed up. Some translations claim that they didn't know who he was. They'd seen him all the time. But the Bible says that he kept them from seeing who he was. And I believe he kept them from seeing who he was because he wanted to know what was their faith. He wanted to hear their story. He didn't want to interfere. He said, well, tell me what's wrong. And they said, you don't know? And that's what the scripture said. Where have you been? You don't know what's happening. It's like any other. I always say, in gossip, there's always a grain of truth, right? So they're like talking. He's like, well, what's going on? And they're like, you don't know? And he said, no, well, tell me. It's just like Jesus to be comforting. Jesus didn't jump up and say, well, I know everything. He didn't say that because, of course, he knew. But he wanted to hear where they were coming from. Amen? Sometimes we need to listen to hear where a person is coming from rather than putting ourselves in the scripture. And it says, didn't you know? He says, what things? What things? He says about Jesus of Nazareth. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed, before God and all the people. Here is a critical statement during 20 where they said, what we had hoped he would be the one to redeem Israel. And the what more, it's the third day and he ain't come back and do nothing. I think that's a very heavy thought that they said, look, we thought he was gonna come and do things and this is 3 days, 1, 2, 3. He's gone and we don't know what to do. But they kept on talking to them and he was like, uh-huh. I can hear Jesus now going, tell me more. And they're like, yes. What I think was deep about these brothers is that they were trusting enough to tell somebody else the story. Even though they had, I don't think they really, see, I'm against all theologians. I don't think they had a doubt Jesus rose. I just think that he didn't do what he's supposed to do. So they were a little upset that they got to deal with that. So they were telling the story. I don't know about you, but that walk, that 7 mile walk in those days and times was dangerous. Here come a dude, show up next to you and be in your business. You know us, we just said, oh, get away from me. And he came up and said, what's going on? Now, any other person would have been suspicious. They'd have said, who are you? Because you know, they could have still been soldiers and spies, still trying to figure out where is that body? And to hear you talking about it, but they never once questioned. I just thought, I said, that's faith right there. That they were so eager to talk it out. And Jesus let them. But then he told them, he said, look, the women went, you know, they said, oh, the women went and they said they didn't see it. And they told us, and some of our friends went, and they didn't see Jesus. They were saying it like, you know, they went, they didn't see it. So they was giving a fact by fact step of what was going on. They didn't divert. We all know as you went through all the scriptures, we went through John, those of you in the John scriptures and other stuff. We know this is the walk. They didn't tell no stories and divert. They wanted this person to know why they were sad. And then Jesus said something that was deep. He said to them, how foolish you are and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things? then enter his glory. And beginning with Moses, all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning him. That's powerful for the, that statement right there is powerful for us as Christians. We have been, many of us went to baby Sunday's cradle roll. Those of you old enough went to cradle roll Bible study in Sunday school. We went to Sunday school. We went to vacation Bible school. Back in the day, you went to something. I don't know if they called it that. But you went there, and all of these truths was plowed into your brain. No, even those of you who are not preachers' kids, these truths were in your head. But when something big happens, you forgot everything. You forget everything. He said, "Well, didn't they tell you this already?" And they were like, "Because they did tell a Messiah was coming, and Isaiah laid it out." That was something that you learned from a baby, like the 23rd Psalm, like the 10 Commandments that no one talks about anymore. We were made to learn those 10 Commandments, buddy. They tell you, stand up, do it. But there were always then, he said, "Well, how slow you are. You don't believe?" And they were like, "Well, no." And they were like this, "Wow, he knows everything." It's always funny. But we got to realize that even the disciples were not faithful. And what's funny, these are disciples that weren't with the 12. These were not the ones that walked with Jesus every minute. These are the peripheral disciples. The point is they believed even though they were on the edge. We got a lot of people, my brothers and sisters, that believe in God, believe in the scripture, that younger people especially, they said they're not Christian and not going to church. That's not that they don't believe. It's just that we have not told them what we believe. We're too busy bossing them around. Instead of saying, "Look, this is how it happened to me. I was sick. This happened to me. It happened to my parents. I prayed. I believe. I still believe," because that's what happened. Some people are killing themselves or running around shooting people up in places. Young people, we're not talking about old people. They're running around shooting folk because they don't have nothing to hold on to. Many of us surviving now because we got something to hold on to. These men right here were holding on to the promise. They said, "We're going to hold on to the promise that this man may not have saved us." And Jesus went on. Jesus was teaching them. He said, look, back, let's look at the scriptures. They went back and they listened to him. You don't see nowhere where they told him he was wrong. I would have been suspicious. You don't know about Jesus died, but you know all of this. That would have been me. You know, me, God be questioning. They were like, "Come on, yes, tell us more." And I could see their eager faces. "Talk to us. This is what happened." And he's like, because sometimes we don't need to tell people everything we know. Sometimes we need to hush. Somebody was telling me about COVID-19. Well, I've been studying COVID-19 since the day after my birthday, February 20th, 2020. I was on a cruise ship and I heard the man say, somebody said, I won't say it, he said here because it's politically different, to say that it would be over by April. I woke up that day, I said, "What April?" And I said, "From that day on, I'm going to study this, because if he says it's going to be over by April, I need to know, me, Jesus is going to rise, or is it over, COVID going to be over by which April? Next April?" And my people was in my room with me, the two ladies that was with me, I had us pack our stuff, put our stuff in a box. I said, "Come on. We put our stuff in a suitcase, but we may have to get off the next flight and go home." They go, What's wrong with you?" Now they're 70 something. Because I didn't know what was happening. As soon as we got home, they shut everything down, didn't it? And those ladies said, "You knew something." I said, "Something sounded funny, but I had to think back." And sometimes you have to think back to what you know. I had watched a show in January on Netflix or something, where they talked about the next pandemic. I swear, it's January. Go look at it. You can look at it for yourself. And it talked about what would happen if another pandemic hit us. And I already saw this on TV, and that people would have to do it. I said, "Let me go." And then when I heard it, it hit my head. Oh, these people already knew about this. That's fact. And they were like, "We ain't going." I said, "We're going to get off of here. If they tell us to get off, we get off the next place. We're going to get some money and fly home. We're going to call the insurance people." And we're all living, we're well, thank God for us. But they said, "You were right." I said, "That's why I brought all that stuff to clean." I brought a lot of stuff to clean anyway, even then. But I didn't realize, I was doing, you should see me, these pictures of me, I was doing. I said, "See, Sometimes we got to look at what we know. We got to depend on, and I hear they laid it out. You can go for yourself on YouTube, you can look at Netflix, or you can look at, and you can see a show called The Next Pandemic. It lines out the pandemic research, when it stopped and everything, and what needed to be done. I ain't lying. It was on before this. So you know they knew something before this. And what happened is, if you really look all the way back to 2016 and you do your research, 2016, there was a panel set up about COVID-19 where they talked about these same facts. I went back and did my research because I said, I'm going to guard myself against this COVID-19. But I need to do it as a pastor to know from knowledge, not from hearsay and rumor. But it's been out since 2016. Certain things, not about COVID, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that certain basics. And that's why I stay on TV every day for a year, 6 months a year, to see what this is about. My thing is, we have to use our knowledge. These guys sat down and he explained to the, Jesus came and he explained to them what was said in the scriptures concerning him. And they accepted it because it's something they had heard from babyhood. They'd always been told, a Messiah is coming and this is what's going to happen. So when they heard it, they opened their mind a little bit more. And then as they began to approach the village of Emmaus, Jesus acted as though he was going to go on. That's in scripture 28. But they urged him strongly, stay with us. It's nearly evening. The day is almost over. So he went to stay with them. Out of all the appearances of the risen Christ, he went to the women, he went to Peter, but right here, these two men that we don't know where they come from, we can't expect, so we know the name of one of them, we don't know where they come from, but they knew the disciples and the apostles themselves. They knew it, and they were ready. They weren't going to let this man go. He was giving them the word. When you have someone who is feeding you the right stuff, I say, my brothers and sisters, don't get rid of them because they're giving you the right stuff. Because you got a lot of people that feed you the wrong thing. But Jesus was feeding, and they took care of Jesus. That's what I'm trying to say here, is that they took care of Jesus. They said, okay, Jesus, you come. Whoever, they know what Jesus yet. They said, come and eat with us. Stay with us. Don't leave us yet. And he said, good. So he came, and he sat down. He came to reveal himself, to lift up our heart. Jesus was for the common man and woman. He was a loving Lord. Like I said in the beginning, he didn't reveal himself, yes, but he wanted to hear what they had to say and to comfort them. He knew it was going to be important for them to be comforted. Sometimes we need comfort and we don't need to hear a lot of talk. We just want you to be a presence. And if I ask you for information, then I get up. You know what I'm saying? If I say I need, because sometimes you do know better than what you hear. But sometimes they need to hear themselves talk. Amen? Amen. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to them. They said, whoa, this is what happened before. Then their eyes opened and they recognized him. And then he disappeared from their sight. Wow, wow. They asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked to us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? In the history of John Wesley, those who were Wesleyan, you will know that his experience happened, that changed a lot of things in his life, happened one day when he was at, he went to a Moravian scripture because he was in his own church, Anglican. But he thought there should be more Bible study, more prayer. He did that back then. We're not talking about right now. That's John Wesley. And John Wesley says he walked out, he felt his heart was strangely warm. In that, thousands of years later, he had an experience of having his heart strangely warm. And they said, wow, he opened the scriptures to our heart warms up. When your heart warms up, you're open to work with others. Amen? To love others because your heart open. He said, Pastor, what does that all mean to us? Well, it means that Jesus, now I put this here, is that Jesus may not be visible to you like he was back in the day. But you can be somebody who's visible Jesus to somebody you know. They can say, because she fed me, because he fed me, he brought me clothes, helped my kid go to school. Because of that, I can say that that's Jesus. Because Jesus is not always going to be obvious and clear to you. You can't do it unless you're a person. Some of us do speak to the Lord and see it. I'm not saying that's not true. People believe that. My point would be that's not the experience of many of us. Many of our word has to come. So therefore, what do we have to do? First of all, we need to study the word. I know as a joke, I ain't gonna talk about the joke about my word teaching, but we need to study the word. And we need to be together when we study the word. Hear me. Jesus was with the two guys. Amen. They already knew some of the word. He knew all of it, but he didn't put it onto them until after he heard what they had to say. Then he filled in their, hear me good now. He filled in what they may have forgotten. He didn't sit there and say, well, I know everything. This is it. He said, okay, let me help you. Here's where you missed some pieces. So they can feel that they had a part of the learning. Amen. Because sometimes we don't let people be a part of the learning. We're too busy telling them what it is. But Jesus said, after they said what they had to say, he said, look, y'all silly people, you know this stuff already. Now I got to explain it. And they were like, yeah, tell us, remind us. And they heard him tell me, so wow, he never put us down. He took care of us. We have to be willing, my brothers and sisters, also, we need to be willing to tell the story. Don't say, well, you know, Jesus. You have to hear it in your heart and then tell the people, well, this is my experience. Give them a miracle experience, a testimony. Amen. We don't testify no more. We just live the thing and we think everything is okay. Well, we should be testifying what happened to me. Amen. Or what happened to you. I always like to tell the story of how I thought I was never going to go. I wanted to go to school, college. And I had a rough home life. I won't discuss that. We'll say it this way. I was getting ready to be put out of my house, and I didn't know where I was going to go when I got 18. I had applied for schools and didn't have no paperwork. I applied, and there was issues. And then one day, a postman walked up on me and said, Marva, here is a letter for you. Now, I've never seen this at postman before. And usually when mail come to your house in those days, when I was younger, the mail went to your parents. It went in the box. I looked at the guy. I took the letter and it was from the university. I opened the letter and it says, you have been accepted to the university in September. You have to pay this, that, and the other. I said, first line was good, right? Second line, oh, where am I getting this money from? The next day, I'm not joking, the next day I got another letter from another group that said that they would pay for me to come this summer, pick up my skills, and they would pay for me to eat and have somewhere to stay. I cried for 2 days, because now I didn't have to worry about being put out of my house. Even if I had nothing, I could go right to the university. So I went right from my house to the university, and then I got another scholarship that paid my tuition. Hear me. That was a miracle to me. But if I don't tell that to somebody who needs to hear it after I hear their story, they're going to say, well, miracles don't happen no more. It happened to me. That was a miracle, y'all. That was a miracle I can testify. And I never would have gotten at it. I went to United Methodist Church. And one day a letter came from the United Methodist Church I was a part of. And they sent me some money that saved me from having to beg for money over the holiday. A check came in. Not a check. No days you could send money. They sent me a letter from the Bushwick United Methodist Church in Brooklyn. And I hadn't been there. I used to go there. Then I left because I used to teach Sunday school and for kids. And a letter came and said, we thought you needed this. This is from your church in the pastor's name. And when I shook it, money fell out. There was enough to pay to tide me over until my money came in from the state. You know how you're for your children. And I wouldn't have, I was like this. Looking at the money because it was enough in cash, not in checks. I mean, I could use it immediately to tide me over that spring break until money came from the state. But I'm saying those are miracles that if I don't tell somebody that it can't happen for you, you won't believe that. And I'm telling you because we need to share the miracles and tell the story. They shared the miracle. They told them Jesus and everything. Then they went back and said, look, and the scripture said, they returned. And they found the 11 and said, it's true. The Lord has arisen and appeared to Simon. Then they told what happened to them. They told what happened to them. I know people laughing at them like, where is he now? Well, we don't know about that. We know that he appeared to us and we're sharing it with you. We need to worship. We need to have a time of worship. As we begin to come back, either online or here, we still need to worship the Lord. Amen. We still need to let God know that we love God. We don't need, you know, I know that for some people, you know, be online or be in the church. We need to worship God. That's all I'm trying to say. We need to still remember what you were taught way back as a baby. As a child, when you were made to come and sit down and, you know, some of us in here are old enough, some of us are too young. We were allowed to run around. I ran around. They tied me down. But anyway, those of us, we're not allowed, but we need to go back to that beginning and know we were taught. That's why they made you stay in church, because you had to learn how to worship. We weren't sent to another room. You better behave in here. And everybody in the room went, you know, in those days they spanked you, or they took a little stick. You know, a lady had a long little switch. And if you got out of the hand, she went, pop. Can't do that now, but we had to sit there and go to sleep one. Point would be we respected that. We learned how to respect that. Now, we may not have done it as we got old, but we always remember in our head what it meant not to worship God. Amen. Finally, I want to say to you, we need to walk with others in our church and outside of our church. We need to be the other person on that road. We need to be the Jesus for somebody who's lost. Amen. We need to be the person who's standing on the road. It says another one on the road. We need to be that person. Nowadays with COVID-19, you might say, well, you know, I can't get close to people. Well, use your phone. My phone tells me when I need to talk to somebody. And you send an email to a person. Someone you ain't heard from in a long time. How's your life? How's your prayer life? Want me to pray for you? Right? I mean, seriously, just call me and say, look, how you doing? My mother's ill, blah, blah, blah. And oh, you want me, that's how you would you like me to pray with you? Here's a scripture. You can feel, you listen to them talk first, see where they are. And then they don't want to be bothered with scripture and prayer. Just say, well, I'm thinking about you. Amen. Don't push it. But they say, you know, yeah, pray for me. I've had people before I was a pastor, they wanted me to pray for them. When I call them now, they'd be like, when are you going to call me? Then I call, we pray. They just want to hear a comforting voice. Now, if no other time in the church for me, I believe this is a time, if we do it right, it can be one of the greatest, greatest harvests in the church, in the world. Because people who have never returned to church will want to come back. Amen? Or they want to come back online or whatever because they're seeking. And we can't afford to have another pandemic hit us in a few years and not be ready. So I think we need to be ready. So my brothers and sisters, you're going to be the other one on the road. I charge you that you will be the other one on the road. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to be consecrated or anything else. You have been charged, I say, to be the other one on the road. Amen? Amen. Thank God.